Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 12010 in the name of Douglas Ross on UK COVID-19 inquiry revelations. I'd invite members wishing to take part in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Douglas Ross to speak to and move the motion. Mr Ross, around 11 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. The COVID-19 pandemic affected people across the globe. Every single person here in Scotland as well. The public were forced to spend months effectively restricted in their homes, unable to see family and friends. They were prevented from doing the activities that they loved, in the places they loved to go, with the people they loved to spend time with. Children missed out on crucial education. Examinations in schools, colleges and universities were affected. Important milestones were delayed or cancelled altogether. And perhaps most devastatingly of all, so many people were denied the chance to say a final goodbye to loved ones in their last moments. These were the hard sacrifices that people here in Scotland made to protect one another. Sacrifices that were made because their governments asked them to, because they believed that these actions were being taken forward for the right reasons, that their protection and the protection of their fellow citizens was the number one priority, the only priority for government in those difficult times. That even if different decisions were being made across the UK, they were being made based on sound public health advice. Now, nearly 4 years on from the start of the first lockdown, the work of the UK COVID inquiry has let us see just how blatantly this SNP government abused that trust. Yeah. This morning, Nicola Sturgeon was asked why she got rid of all of her WhatsApp messages despite knowing a do not destroy order was in place. She was asked why she assured a journalist that all of her messages would be handed over to the inquiry, despite knowing when she gave that answer, she had already deleted them. Nicola Sturgeon has apologised for giving unclear answers, but she should be apologising to the people of Scotland for much, much more. Nicola Sturgeon should be apologising for destroying vital evidence. Nicola Sturgeon should be apologising for misleading the press and the public about deleting those messages. Nicola Sturgeon should be apologising for breaking a clear promise to be open. Nicola Sturgeon should be apologising for her secrecy, her dishonesty and her arrogant disregard for transparency. Now, Presiding Officer, rules of this Parliament prevent me from describing Nicola Sturgeon using the only language I think truly reflects what she did. So while I'm not allowed to say that Nicola Sturgeon is a liar and the UK COVID inquiry has exposed her lies, let me say this. The evidence proves that the former First Minister deliberately made statements she knew to be untrue and deleted key evidence she knew would be requested. But we've learnt more in this COVID inquiry than just the culture of secrecy within the SNP government. Rather than treating the pandemic with the seriousness and sobriety it deserved, we had the Health Secretary, now the First Minister, and the National Clinical Director joking about winging it. Winging it during a pandemic that had killed 10,000 people in Scotland by that point, and they were joking about winging it. Maybe that's why Hamza Yousaf offered to take £100 million out of the NHS budget when it was on its knees during the pandemic. I will give way to Mr Mason.
John Mason.
When he talks about people being serious, does he think Boris Johnson was serious enough about it?
Douglas Ross.
We did have a question in the office, how long it would take the SNP to mention Boris Johnson. I'd gone for earlier than 4 minutes, in fairness. But let's focus on what we are discussing here with the UK COVID inquiry meeting in Scotland and the actions of the SNP Scottish Government during this pandemic. We also know that, as well as winging it, the First Minister, when he was Health Secretary, admitted that he would get found out sooner rather than later. And on that, I think we can agree that Hamza Yousaf was correct. He should not just be apologising for his government's failure to hand over WhatsApp messages, but he should also be apologising for the crass content of those messages and how that has impacted the families of the COVID bereaved. We've also found out in recent days, and again earlier today when the former First Minister was questioned, about minutes that were not taken of key meetings, and that those meetings were even kept secret from Cabinet Secretaries. Members of the Scottish Government Cabinet, who were tasked by all of us to make responsible decisions during the pandemic, were excluded from these meetings. And worse than that, we had the former First Minister and her Chief of Staff plotting to start a good old-fashioned rammy with the UK government for purely political reasons. Let me just repeat that. Nicola Sturgeon and her closest spin doctor thought that they should be acting in purely political ways during a global pandemic. I mean, does any SNP member want to intervene to defend that? None of them. Mr. Mason is going to defend the SNP government for using the pandemic for purely political purposes.
I'm asking again if the UK government and Michael Gove did not do exactly the same.
Douglas Ross.
No, they did not. But what we have seen in this inquiry is the top spin doctor to the former First Minister looking to start a fight with the SNP, with the UK government. Remember, she wanted to ask for things that she knew would be refused. They admitted to wanting to think about something other than sick people. That's what Nicola Sturgeon and her Chief of Staff were discussing. And we now know that in June 2020, just a few months into the pandemic, the SNP government was discussing how the public health crisis could be used to boost independence. Children couldn't go to school, restaurants remained shut, friends and family were just beginning to be able to meet up again. So again, I'll give way to any SNP member. Do they want to defend, months into the pandemic, their SNP government ministers looking to use the pandemic to boost independence? No one's standing up, but some of them are actually laughing, presiding officer. John Mason is still laughing. He thinks this is funny. I will give way to Ruth Maguire in a moment. And when I give way to Ms. Maguire, John Mason might want to take the smirk off of his face in this important debate.
Ruth Maguire.
Presiding officer, I won't be the only person in this chamber who lost someone during the pandemic and who will be finding this display quite despicable. Yeah, we are serious politicians in a serious place. It would be good if we could talk about the actual issues rather than grandstanding. It's a disgrace to the people who lost their lives.
Douglas Ross.
This is the actual debate. And I respect Ruth Maguire. She stood up there and she couldn't defend her own government wanting to use a pandemic to boost independence. I'm not the one grandstanding. That's what Nicola Sturgeon and her cabinet were agreeing months into the pandemic. Just as they always have done and will continue to do, the SNP were fixated by their political obsession when there were far, far bigger issues affecting Scotland, and they are a national disgrace. And all of this, presiding officer, is from the messages we know about, because the then First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, her deputy, John Swinney, and countless political advisers and civil servants all manually deleted their WhatsApp messages. He's not here just now, I know he's in Parliament, but no one will ever refer to Mr. Swinney as Honest John ever again. And Sleekit Sturgeon will be remembered for deleting vital evidence on an industrial sale, denying grieving families the truth they deserve. Now, the current First Minister is winging it so badly that he told the inquiry that he had deleted all his messages, but told the public that he'd retained them. And all of this, with all of these characters, despite both the UK and Scottish inquiries making it clear that destroying evidence, including WhatsApp messages, is an offence. We've seen the National Clinical Director, Jason Leach, describe deleting WhatsApp messages as a pre-bed ritual. Ken Thompson, the Scottish Government Director General at the time, bragged about plausible deniability being his middle name. And the Chief Medical Officer, Gregor Smith, advised his colleagues to delete messages at the end of every day. And John Swinney revealed in his evidence this week that this is a practice that he has been following for 17 years. For 17 years, they have been deleting this evidence. If there was nothing to hide, why did they feel the need to have these daily digital bonfires of evidence, evidence that they knew had been specifically requested by two public inquiries? It can only be, as we've seen from the messages to the UK COVID inquiry, that they've been able to get their hands on because of the appalling culture of secrecy that has permeated through every level of this rotten SNP government. Nicola Sturgeon told us in 2021, in that interview and answer session that I referred to earlier, that for the avoidance of doubt, nothing would be off limits in providing evidence to a public inquiry, including WhatsApps. Yet Jamie Dawson KC said, at the time that request was made, Nicola Sturgeon, the former First Minister of Scotland, had retained no messages whatsoever in connection with her management of the pandemic. So Nicola Sturgeon made the promise of transparency in full knowledge that she had already deleted what evidence she could. Yeah. That far from nothing being off limits, there was nothing to give. What a fraud this woman was. And if the SNP benches don't like that, those are not my words. That is the verdict of one of their former colleagues, the SNP's Joan McAlpine, a verdict that I am sure more and more of the public are beginning to agree with. The Scottish Conservative motion today is calling for the COVID-19 committee to be reconstituted to look into the very serious matters that we have raised, and for Nicola Sturgeon, John Swinney and Hamza Yousaf to be referred to the independent advisor on the ministerial code to look at what has happened. Now, we know that there have been mistakes made by governments across the world during this pandemic. But we now know that the perception that the Scottish Government was better, was whiter than white, was only achieved because they were frantically deleting every shred of evidence that would have shown otherwise. What little we have seen shows a SNP government that is steeped in secrecy, that was joking about the virus spreading across the country, that was winging it instead of making decisions based on hard public health evidence, that was pursuing purely political objectives while people died. For all of the sacrifices that the Scottish people made during the pandemic, the very least they deserve from this SNP government, even at this late stage, is openness and transparency. The fact that it looks like they will never get this is truly unforgivable. I urge members across the chamber today to support the Scottish Conservative motion to get the answers that the public desperately need.
Thank you. I now call on Shona Robertson to speak to and move Amendment 12010.5. Deputy First Minister, around 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The COVID-19 pandemic touched every life in Scotland, and throughout the pandemic, the Scottish Government's absolute priority was always to keep the people of this country safe. The threat posed by a novel virus, whose long-term effects we are still working to fully understand, wrought a fear around the world. Whether through constituents' experience or indeed our own personal experiences, many of whom I know have been personally affected in this chamber, we know of the pain of the loss of loved ones during the COVID-19 pandemic, and I would like to put on record my condolences to all those affected. Loss, of course, was made harder in the early days of the pandemic by the necessities of distancing to help reduce the spread of the virus. And it's that sacrifice that compounded the pain of grief, and I will never be fully able to express my gratitude to the people. Those simple acts of following the rules, despite the absolutely human desire for connection and solace, that were for me the unspoken acts of heroism of the pandemic, as were, of course, the efforts of those who worked on the front line day in, day out, to look after us and to keep us safe. Those in government here, in London, Cardiff, Stormont and across the world were faced with a fast-moving threat that they had to respond to quickly. And to do so, those tasked with taking decisions were, of course, supported by civil servants, scientific advisers and clinical advisers. And I want to place on record my thanks to these staff across the whole of the UK who did their very best in the most challenging of times. The Scottish Government was clear throughout the pandemic that our response would not be perfect, mistakes would be made, and that we hoped that lessons would be learned for the future. That necessity that lessons are learned in case we face a new disease in the future is why we commissioned a judge-led inquiry here in Scotland. Indeed, Scotland is, of course, the only part of the UK with a dedicated national inquiry. That necessity is also why we are participating fully with the UK COVID inquiry. We must learn from our shared experiences and improve together, and that's exactly what we hope these two independent judge-led inquiries will provide. Yes.
Douglas Ross.
Does the Deputy First Minister accept that while everyone wants the inquiries to come up with conclusions that can be used in the future, their work is being hampered because Nicola Sturgeon, John Swinney and senior civil servants deleted key messages that are now not available to the inquiry?
Yeah. Deputy First Minister.
I don't believe that the work of the inquiries is being hampered. I believe they are being robust and will get to the truth of the matter and will put on record their analysis of what they believe has taken place. And they will hold politicians to account throughout these islands for the decisions that they made. And we await their report. Sadly, today's debate is, of course, partisan in nature, taking place before the UK COVID inquiry has even finished taking evidence in Scotland, and on the very day that the former First Minister is giving her evidence. I don't believe that the public will think that politicians are best placed to be judge and jury on the adequacy or otherwise of the response to the pandemic led by other politicians, and that attempts to create some kind of hierarchy of blame where others are always put at the top, I think tells us why the establishment of an independent judge-led inquiry was so important. An inquiry which will scrutinise the decisions made by all governments across the UK without fear or favour and without political interference. Briefly.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful for the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. She said there should be no political interference during the COVID inquiry. Why then, as soon as Boris Johnson and Rishi Sunak stood up, did the Scottish Government jump up and down and make as much noise as they possibly could? Do you not reap what you sow in this debate?
Through the Chair, Deputy First Minister.
There's no comparison, and let me turn to the matter of informal messages such as WhatsApps that has been focused on by Douglas Ross. The policy of the Scottish Government on retention of information to the official record has been set out on a number of occasions, not least by me. Informal messaging is something the Scottish Government has reflected on through this process, and that's why, of course, the First Minister has not only apologised for any hurt caused by the Scottish Government prior handling of the request from the inquiry, but has also announced an externally led review of the use of mobile messaging apps and non-corporate technology. And that's something, of course, we'd be happy to work with any other governments in these islands on, as it appears we are all facing similar issues on this matter. Not just now. A fact demonstrated by the following quote given to the UK inquiry in a witness statement from Rishi Sunak, the Prime Minister, who, of course, provided no messages to the inquiry, but who said, and I quote, "My expectation would be that if the officials on those groups had considered that any information being communicated by WhatsApp message needed to be preserved to form part of the official record, then those officials would have taken steps to ensure that that happened." And of course, in a minute, and of course, the material this government has provided to the UK inquiry to date includes emails, messages, submissions and advice to ministers and papers from key decision-making meetings, including the Scottish Cabinet. In total, more than 19,000 documents and almost 28,000 messages have been provided. Briefly,
Douglas Ross.
If the Scottish Government policy of deleting messages is the correct one and so important, why did Kate Forbes, as Finance Secretary, not know about it? And why did Hamza Youssef, the current First Minister, not follow it?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, what I have been really clear is setting out the policy that was about making sure that any salient points were transcribed to the official record and then other information could be deleted thereafter. That has been the policy, and that is the policy that I set out in detail in the statement to this Parliament. The UK inquiry has, in the last few weeks, touched on a range of issues that will inform how we prepare for the future. The UK inquiry is currently on Module 2A, but in time we'll move on to other specific aspects of the response to the pandemic, including Module 5 on procurement. In fact, the preliminary hearing for Module 5 will take place in London next week. Module 5 will be important, Presiding Officer, because it will consider issues such as the prevalence of fraud in PPE contracts, including the UK Government's so-called high priority lane, among other matters. Separately, there are also clearly ongoing investigations from the National Crime Agency into suspected criminal offences in relation to UK Government PPE contracts. I believe all this adds weight to the calls for the creation of a UK COVID Corruption Commissioner, and this Government will support efforts of any future UK Government to establish such a role to seek to recoup public funds lost to waste and fraud. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, our thoughts and sympathies go to everyone who was impacted by the pandemic. I believe the work of the inquiries is vital to give an independent view and consideration of the handling of the pandemic across the UK, free from political interference. I think it's right and proper that politicians of all parties should allow the inquiries to get on with their work, and we will await their conclusions and then we will respond as appropriate. I look forward to continuing to provide the inquiries with the material they need to do their job, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Just to advise the Chamber, there really is no time in hand, so members will have to stick to their speaking time allocations and accommodate interventions. Within that, I call Jackie Bailey to speak to and move Amendment 12010.3 up to 7 minutes. Ms Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we debate the culture of secrecy and cover-up that has been laid bare in the UK COVID-19 inquiry, let us remember at the heart of this scandal are the people who lost their lives and families who lost their loved ones. It is for them that we search for answers and call out that culture of cover-up at the very heart of this government. In recent weeks, we've seen revealed that Nicola Sturgeon, John Swinney, Jason Leach, other officials, too numerous to name, have deleted all of their pandemic WhatsApp messages. Nicola Sturgeon described Boris Johnson as a clown. Many might agree with her, but no one thinks that of Nicola Sturgeon. She is a clever woman, so what she has done is deliberate. Some have described it as cynical and calculating. Whether you agree with that or not, it is deliberate. This week, Jean Freeman admitted that the SNP government was not prepared for the pandemic. Kate Forbes has challenged the deletion of evidence by her own colleagues, and Nicola Sturgeon today confirms she misled the nation and puts the boot into poor Hamza Youssef. The inquiry was able to scrutinise the WhatsApp messages of UK government ministers and officials. It will have no such ability to scrutinise the totality of the decision-making process of Nicola Sturgeon and her advisers, thanks to the systematic destruction of evidence on a truly industrial scale. That is utterly shameful and a complete betrayal of trust. The SNP's arrogance and sense of impunity has robbed the public of any chance of properly understanding what happened during the pandemic. The discharge of patients to care homes untested, the closure of businesses, the shutting down of our schools. And of course, more than 17,000 Scots died from COVID-19. The loss of each of these lives is a tragedy. Yet one surviving WhatsApp exchange reveals that the SNP chief of staff was much more concerned with stoking a good old-fashioned rammy with the UK government so she could stop thinking about something other than sick people. The outrage of a comment like that surpasses party politics. This attitude at the very centre of government is utterly indefensible. 17,000 lives lost, but the SNP's priority was constitutional bickering. When asked about this, the former First Minister simply failed to tell the truth. We have no answers as to why key and often deadly decisions were made, but what we do have is proof positive of the SNP's skewed priorities. And it isn't the first time, Presiding Officer, that the SNP has attempted to conceal the truth from voters. Over the last 17 years, they have instilled a culture of secrecy and cover-up, which now permeates Scottish politics. Now, I've been in the Parliament for some time, since the beginning. I've had a ringside seat to the erosion of accountability and the shroud of secrecy at its worst when Nicola Sturgeon and John Swinney were in charge. The SNP have long berated the Tories at Westminster for its sense of closed government, but it seems that these protests were a case of do as I say, not as I do. Transparency and openness should be practised by everyone else, but not the SNP when it comes down to it, because it's one rule for them and another for the rest of us. The use of private, un-FOI-able SNP emails for official conversations, the mass destruction of discussion chains and the ongoing misleading of Parliament cannot continue. This goes beyond political scandal. It is a potential breach of the law. Officials appear happy to give way.
Rachel Hamilton.
Okay. We're taking the intervention. Does she agree with the Conservatives on these benches that we should reconvene the COVID-19 committee so that we can get some transparency around the decision-making around the pandemic?
Jackie Bailey.
Whilst I have no objection to that, I'm unclear how a committee would do any better than Lady Hallett is doing, in fairness. Having been on the Salmon Committee, I understand the frustration, frankly, of trying to get information from the government, and I reckon Lady Hallett's chances are better.
Ms Bailey, could you resume your seat a second? There is far too much background noise. There's far too much background noise. Let's have the respect and listen to the person who has the floor. Jackie Bailey.
Thank you. I was coming on to why I think this is a potential breach of the law, because officials appear to have deliberately attempted to communicate in ways which would avoid government decision-making being covered by FOI requests. Now, I'm sure the attention will now turn to whether there was a breach of the Inquiries Act and the Freedom of Information Act, and whether there is indeed a need for a formal police investigation. I would also like the Permanent Secretary to review the Civil Service Code, as I cannot believe it is acceptable for the custodian of the document retention policy to be telling people how to avoid compliance with it. I cannot believe it is acceptable that the National Clinical Director, who helped shape the regulations, was telling a minister how to get round them. Ministers have misled this Parliament. The SNP have misled Scotland. That culture of secrecy and cover-up must end, because the people of Scotland deserve so much better than this. Presiding Officer, I believe change is possible. Scottish Labour would transform government and clean up the Scottish Parliament. We would conduct a full review of parliamentary procedures to ensure Parliament is robust and reflective of people's daily experiences. We would place a limit on the number of ministerial and government posts and strengthen the effectiveness of the committee system. We would address problems with accountability and transparency, providing protection for whistleblowers, introducing a right of recall for MSPs, and establishing consequences for breaking the ministerial code, which this government seems to do with impunity. The people of Scotland can no longer trust the SNP. They've been taken for granted by a party that is out of touch and out of ideas. And this isn't just about the inquiry. This is about how this government operates. A culture of secrecy that goes from the First Minister right down. Enough is enough, Presiding Officer. It's time for change, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton up to 6 minutes. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak with the Liberal Democrats in today's debate. Presiding Officer, outside the COVID-19 inquiry in Edinburgh last week, a member of the COVID-bereaved families held back tears, as she said of the former First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, and I quote, "I'm absolutely ashamed and devastated to hear what she's doing now. I can't believe it." She was there representing just one of millions of Scots families who hung on the former First Minister's every word during those daily lunchtime briefings. Presiding Officer, those families shaped their worlds around the policies spelled out from that Bute House podium, and who saw their lives and the lives of their loved ones curtailed and, yes, in some cases even foreshortened by those same policies. But now, at the time of asking, when it matters most, the former First Minister's words, words which define the culture and the calculation that underpinned those life and death decisions, have been rendered almost wholly irretrievable. Presiding Officer, it is now clear that a full narrative account of Scotland's pandemic story will be forever denied to the families at the heart of this. And what is worse, it is denied to them by an act of willful concealment by Nicola Sturgeon and by those around her. The most difficult moment for Nicola Sturgeon in her testimony before the inquiry this morning came when, in cross-examination, Jamie Dawson Casey asked her about assurances that she had made to Kieran Jenkins of Channel 4 News that she would retain not just the salient points of her WhatsApps and other private messages, but submit them wholesale and in their entirety to the inquiry that she knew was sure to follow. She was forced to make clear to the inquiry today that she never had any intention of fulfilling that assurance, because at the time of making it, she was personally deleting every one of those messages. Now, she apologised to the inquiry and then repeated almost word for word the same justification for the complete excision of those messages that was offered to the inquiry just yesterday by her deputy, John Swinney, that such messages were of little consequence. And in any case, since 2007, SNP ministers had been strongly advised by the civil service to delete all messages or private messages once key points had been transferred to the official government record. So that should a phone or other device be lost or stolen, sensitive correspondence would not be compromised. It does bear stating, Presiding Officer, that this was a policy that was not actually codified until November 2021, several months after the Scottish Government had itself issued a do not destroy notice for such a material. It's perhaps why neither Kate Forbes or Jean Freeman, ministers of some time served, knew nothing of such a policy. But here's where I get stuck. Members will recall that I, along with Jackie Bailey, served on the Committee of Inquiry into the Scottish Government's handling of harassment complaints, the Salmon Inquiry. If, as we've heard, Nicola Sturgeon only ever used her own personal phone, if we are to believe that since 2007, she routinely followed advice from civil servants by deleting all of her private messages to avoid them being compromised in any way, how is it then that Nicola Sturgeon was able to furnish our inquiry with literally pages and pages of WhatsApp messages retrieved from her phone between herself and Alex Salmond, sent in 2017? Those messages were of a highly personal and sensitive nature. If her pandemic WhatsApps were of such little consequence, why delete one set and not the other? All that the grieving families at the heart of this have to go on now are the remnants of a few pieced-together conversations. It's not what they were promised. Those messages matter because what little we have seen, we catch a glimpse of that culture behind the decisions we all had to live and in some cases die with and under. On 20th of May 2021, Humza Yousaf wrote, and we heard this today, as we have done several times in this inquiry, an exchange between himself and Jason Leach. And it starts with Humza Yousaf saying, "There was some First Minister, keep it small, shenanigans, as always." And Jason Leach replied, "She actually wants none of us." Now, the former First Minister definitely tried to spin this as just not wanting to cast a cast of thousands at every meeting. But I think it speaks to something more. In many ways, a government within a government. A pandemic response governed in large part by a shadowy central committee we now know as Gold Command. I say shadowy because it's a central committee with no meeting diet and no minutes. A committee about which the finance secretary, Kate Forbes, knew absolutely nothing for much of her first months in office. Yet this was the committee that formed in large part the wheelhouse of our pandemic response. It provided options and decisions for ratification by Cabinet. Over the summer recess months, it was actually the only group to which the First Minister would refer to sense check decisions. Ministers must at times have felt like window dressing. Decisions, it seems, were taken by a very limited number of individuals, some of them not even elected. Presiding officer, this was a time when this Parliament had transferred an unprecedented level of power to Scottish ministers. I do not remember any clause of the Coronavirus Act ceding such control to such a committee. But sometimes even that was circumvented, and on 18th of March, as many others did, I packed my 11-year-old boy off for what would be his last day in Primary 7. It turns out, from testimony we received yesterday, only John Swinney, only Nicola Sturgeon took that decision, and they did so without reference to Cabinet discussion. No analysis of the impact on the poverty-related attainment gap, and no one... If I've got time, I'm
nope.
Afraid I'm closing. Unfortunately, I would have. And no analysis of children's mental health. All of us had to live with these decisions. The families of the bereaved had to live with these decisions. They're now looking for answers. Answers they will be forever denied. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole Hamilton. We now move to the open debate. I call first Craig Hoy to be followed by Kevin Stewart. 5 minutes, Mr. Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This SNP government tells lies. It does so willfully, and it does so willingly, and it does so
Mr.
to cover
Hoy,
up the truth.
Could I advise you, please, to respect the rules in relation to what is acceptable language in this chamber? Mr. Hoy.
OK, this SNP government has told untruths. It does so willfully, and it does so willingly, and it does so to cover up the truth. To save its own skin, it spends the public's money going to court to prevent the public from knowing the truth. It is secretive, and it is manipulative. It puts Scottish nationalism ahead of the Scottish people. It stops the public from knowing how decisions were taken. It puts a smokescreen around who took those decisions and why they did so. And worse still, in a pandemic, at a time of life and death, deceit and delete became the default options. And we know now that the secrets which expose the rotten underbelly of the Scottish National Party are plain to see. Because in this inquiry, they have made a mistake. Because you can fool some of the people all of the time, and all of the people some of the time, but you cannot fool all of the people all of the time. And now we know something that we have long suspected. This SNP government tried to play the public for fools, using the pandemic for political purposes. For it was there for all to see in a WhatsApp message from Liz Lloyd, a constitutional rammy to further Nicola Sturgeon's independence obsession. But yet still, with a public inquiry, we only know the half of it, because the words of Donald Rumsfeld are actually quite helpful here. There are no knowns. There are things that we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know, but there are also unknown unknowns, the ones we don't know that we don't know. And that is the core of the problem. We simply do not know what we do not know, because Nicola Sturgeon conducted a digital bonfire to get rid of the evidence. Evidence that would be relevant to a public inquiry that she knew was coming. But it wasn't just Nicola Sturgeon. John Swinney, Jason Leach and others deleted their COVID WhatsApp messages. Plausible deniability, they called it. Decisions deleted, vital information lost. Answers for grieving families that will now remain as unknown unknowns forever. And we found out yesterday that a shady cabal were taking key COVID decisions. Discussing the clandestine, formerly unminuted Gold Command meetings, Kate Forbes told the inquiry, "I wasn't invited. I'm not even sure I was aware that they existed." Presiding officer, the SNP don't just mislead the public, they mislead their own people too. Take these words from Nicola Sturgeon, contained in a leaked video. "There are no reasons for people to be concerned about the party's finances, and all of us need to be careful about not suggesting that there is." No reasons to be concerned. But just weeks later, Her husband, Peter Murrow, made a secret loan to prop up the SNP's party finances. A luxury camper van appeared on the party's books. A police investigation led to three arrests, including that of Nicola Sturgeon herself. And just this weekend, media reports alleged that signatures on the SNP's accounts may have been falsified. And the investigation still continues.
Mr Hoy, within your 5 minutes, I would expect you to stick to the detail of the motion that Douglas Ross has put to
this. It's about transparency. And the investigation still continues. The nation's money is being spent to investigate its very own government. And this is just the tip of the transparency iceberg. Take the two ferries rusting on the banks of the Clyde. Procurement rules ignored, key messages not minuted, more than a whiff of secrecy in the air. Or take the ongoing secrecy surrounding the Alex Salmond trial. Only last month, the SNP government was told by the Court of Session that it had no legal basis upon which to withhold evidence gathered during the investigation into whether Nicola Sturgeon breached the ministerial code. What a cynical shower of charlatans. But their mask has slipped. Nicola Sturgeon stood at that podium each and every day, but at the self-same time, she and her cynical cabal were secretly seeking to use the pandemic to promote independence. And Hamza Yousaf has got questions to answer too. He admitted himself something we've all known, that he's out of his depth and will be found out sooner than later. Well, thanks to the public inquiry, we have finally found them out, but not before real damage has been done. An SNP government that was meant to be off the people, for the people, was actually sneering at the people. Such is the intoxicated arrogance of 17 years of SNP misrule. They have run out of excuses, they have run out of credibility, and they should be run out of government.
I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Alec Rowley. Up to 6 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Presiding Officer, during the course of this debate, I've received a message from a friend of mine who lost a family member to COVID, and I'm going to quote what they have just said. I simply wish that, as a relative, that all sides would stop trying to play politics and leave the inquiry to get on with its job. And we're hearing laughter from the Tory benches. Presiding Officer, my heart goes out to all of those who lost loved ones to COVID-19, to those individuals, families and communities who suffered during the pandemic, and to those that are still feeling the impact of what was, in my opinion, the most traumatic event of our lifetimes. My thanks goes to all of the public servants, the experts, the community groups and the many others who helped the Scottish Government and their fellow Scots navigate the difficult path that COVID-19 laid in front of us. Many people went beyond the call of duty to do their best, and my hope was that their work, their efforts, their help would have featured more in the analysis of what went on during the course of the pandemic. Personally, I'm grateful to the likes of Lorraine McGrath, the Chief Executive of the Simon Community and Streetworks, for the work that she, her team, other third sector partners and civil servants carried out to ensure that all rough sleepers were brought off the streets and safely accommodated. I'm obliged to folk like Alan Wilson of Select and other construction industry leaders for their cooperation, their input and their patience during tough times. And I'm humbled by the commitment of the Care Home Relative Scotland members who scrutinised, cajoled and advocated for families who had loved ones in our care homes, even when they were often feeling anguish, loss and despair themselves. These heroes need the answers from the inquiries. They need to know about the decision making that took place and where we got it right, where we got it wrong, and what changes need to be put in place to do better, our best, in the future. The government has reiterated again and again that it is committed to openness and transparency in decision making. And that is why the Scottish Government established the first public inquiry in the UK to examine the response to COVID-19. And that, of course, was announced in December of 2021, ahead of the UK Government commencing the UK-wide public inquiry. The inquiries were I'll take a very brief intervention.
Jimmy Hawker-Johnson.
Thank you. To Kevin Stewart for allowing the intervention. In the interest of transparency, he was a minister during the COVID pandemic. Did he delete his emails and his WhatsApp messages? Was he asked to supply them to the inquiry? And would he consider the deletion of emails wrong?
Kevin Stewart.
I have deleted no emails, presiding officer. As I said, the inquiries were established to help identify what could have been done better and to improve government decision-making in a pandemic to save lives and prevent suffering in the future. The government, the Scottish Government, has committed to examining and considering closely the recommendations that both the Scottish and the UK public inquiries make. In my opinion, it is entirely inappropriate to comment on the detail of evidence being considered by the COVID inquiries while hearings are ongoing. And it has been the norm in this place in the past that detailed matters pertaining to an inquiry are not debated while the inquiry is sitting. What is happening here does a disservice to those who have lost loved ones and who are seeking answers. And the most important way to recognise the loss and the suffering of the people of Scotland and of the wider UK population during the pandemic is to let the inquiries do their job, learn from the evidence and implement the recommendations. Presiding officer, I go back to the start of my speech because obviously, as we are debating this today, it is having an impact on people at home. It is time to stop the politicking here. It is time to let the inquiries do their job. It is time to ensure that people get the answers that they deserve. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I now call Alec Rowley to be followed by Bob Doris. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While we have this debate today, we must never forget the levels of suffering that many families went through as a result of the pandemic. And the Scottish COVID bereaved families' bravery in sharing their experiences of the pandemic throughout the inquiry are a stark reminder of the many ways in which people in Scotland suffered immense pain, loss and hurt at an unprecedented time of fear and confusion around the globe. I think most people in Scotland want to understand how decisions were made and on what basis those decisions were made. Both at a UK and Scottish level, it is disappointing, therefore, that the issue of deleted information and missing messages has become so prominent. This has added to the grief that many families are suffering. So I was pleased that the First Minister recognised at least one of those failures, as he unreservedly apologised to the inquiry and to those mourning the loss of a loved one for what he described as, I quote, frankly poor, unquote, handling of inquiry requests by the Scottish Government. I believe it is fair to conclude from the revelations of the inquiry so far that there are issues within the Scottish Government when it comes to transparency and scrutiny. Bearing in mind the UK inquiry is expected to be taking evidence into the summer of 2026, I think a legitimate question for this Parliament is, should any action be taken to examine any of the issues around the decisions that were taken and recorded across government? So I think it is fair to ask, do we need to review data retention policies, our approach to freedom of information, and insist, as the people of this country insist, on full transparency from our political representatives and governments? If we can turn to the motions briefly, in terms of the motion from the Tories, the idea of the COVID Recovery Committee being reconstituted, I agree with Jackie Bailey, you're not going to try and run some kind of inquiry, but I would say I think there's merit here because I think, and I hopefully have the time to go on and explain my thinking around this, there are issues coming up and it's not about looking back and making judgments, it's actually looking forward and saying if there is bad practice here, What are we as a Parliament going to do to actually look at that? So I do believe there is merit in what's been suggested. And I hope that away from this place, parties can get, look together and discuss together and look at how we can address some of those issues. In terms of the amendment that will be passed today, because the government parties have the numbers, it notes that 28,000 messages and 19,000 documents have been handed to the COVID inquiry. What I think, and I say this sincerely, I think failing to actually also note that there are texts or whatever that are missing, failing to do that will just cause more grief for the people out there. I don't know if Sona Robinson has watched some of the television interviews with bereaved families over the last few weeks. A lot of them are absolutely heartbroken and feel let down. Now, until the inquiry, until that inquiry reports, you know, we won't know the detail and how the inquiry is going to look at those missing WhatsApps and whatever, but we at least should have, and anything passed in here, acknowledged that it was an issue. The First Ministers went and apologised. I believe with sincerity that would have made that a better motion. But
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. Does he really think there's vital information in the WhatsApp messages, or is it just chit-chat and gossip?
Alec Rowley. Well, that's the problem. I don't know. I don't know, and neither does others. And so that's why I think we need to at least acknowledge that there has been an issue there. The other part, I should say, by the way, of the amendment that will get passed today, Rachel Reeves at Labour conference announced that the next Labour government would create a powerful COVID corruption commission. She talked about aiming initially to get at least $2.6 billion of lost public funds. It is estimated $2 billion was lost in fraud from COVID support schemes, including from business loans, grants, furlough and eat out to help out. So Labour are absolutely committed to that at a UK level, and should I say, quite rightly so. If I could move on, there are other issues that I think I could touch on briefly. Were we prepared for COVID? And it's clear that we weren't prepared. It's clear that the whole of the UK was not prepared. On the COVID Recovery Committee, the experts continually said that if you had a well-funded health service, well-resourced and well-functioning, that the countries who had that were the best prepared for any kind of pandemic. And I know that people have read the other day this is a 100-year event. A lot of those experts also warned that with the changes in climate, the changes around the world, there is actually more and more risk. So again, it may be that the proposal that's coming forward to look at some kind of committee, that would look at, are we prepared now? So we can learn the lessons, not to just wait until the report comes. But I'm out of time, so I'll thank you for that, President's offer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rowley. I now call Bob Dorris to be followed by Pam Gosthell. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Dorris. Can we have Mr. Dorris's camera and audio, please?
Can you hear me now, Presiding Officer?
I can hear you. Yeah, up to 6 minutes, Mr. Dorris.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, in 2020 and through to 2021, Scotland was, along with nations across the world, seeking to grapple with an unprecedented global pandemic, certainly unprecedented in modern times. Now, my parents passed away a few years earlier, in 2015 and 2016. I can't comprehend how I would have felt had I had to visit my mum and look at her through a window, or not being able to see my dad again due to COVID-19 infection control, or indeed had either lost either of them in a care home as a consequence of COVID-19. I did lose one of my best friends during COVID-19, although not through COVID, and attended a graveyard service. At that time, 20 were allowed to attend. I wasn't sure if I made 21, so I stood back apart from the graveside service. But I did approach David's mum and dad to offer my condolences once the service had ended. I didn't hug them, but I wanted to. Presiding Officer, families that were separated from loved ones due to COVID-19, many never to see loved ones again, often unable to attend funerals and show their last respects want to ensure scrutiny of the governments, of all governments that made these decisions, and for lessons to be learned. That is surely what both the Scottish and UK public inquiries are seeking to do. My wife worked as a nurse in the NHS critical care ward right through COVID-19. I'm still not sure of the impact on my wife beyond the awful marks the fitted masks made on her face when she turned home from work every night. But more generally, COVID-19 will have taken its toll. I'm not sure I'll ever know how much. I want to make sure both public inquiries fully interrogate on the preparedness of Scotland's and other UK NHS systems, on our care homes and in other key areas, as well as our staff, our frontline staff, were supported. I was lucky during COVID-19. My salary was secure. I didn't lose a loved one directly to COVID during that time. I had living space and a garden for my kids to run about in. Those staying in overcrowded properties without access to living space or gardens, or asylum seekers pushed by the Home Office into hotels and out of tenancies, those that lost businesses or suffered financial hardship, they will all wish to see inquiries analyse decisions taken by all governments. My job as an MSP at that time, and I know colleagues right across all parties will recognise this, was often doing my best to seek and secure robust and reliable information and guidance to constituents, to community groups and to local businesses. My office team were outstanding in their efforts, and I put that on the record here this afternoon. But it was challenging. People needed clarity and certainty, and they wanted it in real time. For them, for their loved ones, for their livelihoods, for their mental well-being, often as much as their physical well-being. That clarity, that advice, that certainty had to be provided by ministers, cabinet secretaries, civil servants, special advisers, clinical advisers, and a whirl of other people almost certainly at the heart of decision-making, often at breakneck speed. Did they get everything right? Of course not. Did they by and large work diligently, compassionately, professionally and strenuously over many months, acting in what they believed were in all their best interests? I believe so. But, presiding officer, some might say I would say that. I'm a backbench MSP of the Scottish Government. I suspect there are Conservative MPs in England saying the inquiry there should be allowed to do its work. And indeed, Labour members of the Senate in Wales saying something similar in terms of the actions and behaviours of the Welsh Government. I get it. That kind of gets to the nub of the Conservative motion in the Parliament this afternoon. Many will see the Conservative motion this afternoon for what it is, dripping with opportunism and hypocrisy. The public inquiries will scrutinise without fear or favour and without politicisation. They will draw conclusions based on all the evidence they hear, not on the politicised, partial and opportunistic comments of Douglas Ross or even Jackie Bailey. The inquiries won't cherry pick. They won't take parts of evidence out of context. They won't rush to judge and reach findings based on trying to grab media headlines for political expediency. In other words, they won't act like the Conservative Party. And Douglas Ross mentioned a WhatsApp message regarding the SNP causing a political rammy during COVID-19. Now, from my interpretation of that exchange, it revolved around the need for Scotland to secure furlough payments that otherwise would have been denied to our businesses and our workforce, financial support that the UK government may deny and the Scottish government didn't have the power to deliver. But that's my opinion. It's opinion. The Conservatives and Labour are likely to disagree with that. The difference is I wish to let COVID-19 inquiries go on with looking at the evidence and not rush to judge for raw political advantage. In closing, presiding officer, I have not focused on the many shortcomings and failings of Boris Johnson and the Tories during COVID-19. The judge-led inquiries will no doubt have something to say about that. Instead, I have focused on the work of the inquiries and hope that we can get beyond the raw politics and let the inquiries do their work. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr Dorris. I now call Pam Gosell to be followed by John Mason. Up to 5 minutes, Ms Gosell.
Thank you, presiding officer. Summarising 17 years of deceit and cover-up in no more than 5 minutes is near impossible. But thanks to the motion brought forward by the Scottish Conservatives, we can begin dissecting the shocking revelations from the UK COVID inquiry in Scotland so far. The pandemic was a real test of leadership. Political leaders were faced with tough choices, which I'm sure we can all sympathise with. Decisions were made that affected lives, livelihoods, education and resilience. And we can only but trust that when that storm passes, political leaders can give an account of why decisions were made. But an SNP government addicted to secrecy has made that near impossible task. And now Breed families have questions they may never get the answers to. Just today, we found out that Nicola Sturgeon was economical with the truth when she today told the media in 2021 that no evidence would be off limits. We now know that she had already destroyed it, although amazingly, she still had the WhatsApp exchanges with her one-time best buddy, Alex Salmond. And John Sweeney deleted messages between himself and Nicola Sturgeon. And former Chief of Staff Liz Lloyd did the same. A clear, concerted effort to hide crucial messages by key decision makers. Yeah. We now know that vital Gold Command meetings were kept secret for some of the most senior ministers at that time, including Kate Forbes. Much to no one's surprise, they claim they have no minutes for these meetings. It is inconceivable that civil servants did not take notes at these meetings. Where are these notes? Instead, the bereaved will have to put their faith in Nicola Sturgeon's selective memory and politically driven decision-making. Sadly, the evidence that remains shows that decisions made by Nicola Sturgeon and her closest colleagues were most likely drawn up on the back of a fag packet. It is not just poor decision-making. It was their motivation, because the public will ask, surely the Scottish Government would not allow grievance to drive decision-making while lives and livelihoods are on the line. But that is indeed what happened. Nicola Sturgeon's chief adviser wanted to create a good old-fashioned rammy with the UK Government and call for things they can't do. At this point, I think it's reasonable to conclude that their obsession with independence borders on dangerous and clouded their judgment. It came as no surprise to hear Hamza Yousaf had been winging it in his time as Health Secretary.
Still is.
That was much obvious. Much more surprising was that despite their continued assertion of moral superiority, Hamza Yousaf was all too happy to take advice from Jason Leach, the chief clinical adviser, on how to bend the rules that they were imposing on everybody else. It was also enlightening to see what a laugh the SNP had at the expense of the public, joking about how they would delete messages and subvert freedom of information requests. It doesn't surprise me that the SNP derives so much pleasure from avoiding public scrutiny. After all, they have treated the public and the Parliament with utter contempt. All this from the self-proclaimed most transparent party in Scotland, I write. If that were the case, they would commit to reconvening the COVID-19 Recovery Committee so that the Parliament can also scrutinise these revelations so that they should refer themselves for an independent investigation. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the UK COVID inquiry has laid bare a culture of secrecy within this SNP Scottish Government that has rotted from the top down, a culture which runs through ministers both past and present. It has also confirmed what everyone could already see, that even during the global pandemic, the SNP Scottish Government still tried to manufacture as much conflict and as much political grievance as possible. Independence at any cost, even when lives were on the line. The SNP played a blinder. They had many fooled. But grieving families want justice. They want answers. They are nobody's fool.
Thank you, Ms Gozo. I now call on John Mason to be followed by Jamie Green. Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to take part in today's debate. I do get the feeling we've been here before. Again, we seem to be concentrating on WhatsApp messages, all the chit-chat and gossip that went on, and who would use such sweary words about whom. I had to say, I thought the focus of the public inquiry would be on some of the big actual decisions that were made or not made, if it's very brief.
Michael Marra.
Recognised in the evidence heard by the COVID inquiry that there are substantial messages between the former First Minister and advisor where the key decisions are discussed. That's not chit-chat and gossip. It's the business of government making decisions.
John Mason.
I mean, it seems to me that very little has come out of the public inquiry so far, either from WhatsApp messages in London or WhatsApp messages in Scotland. There is very little new, actual, solid information. The kind of questions I thought they would be looking at were, did lockdown start at the right time? Do we need to have more test capacity, even if that diverts resources away from day-to-day medical care? Were the schools closed at the right times? Were school exams handled properly? And maybe these are the questions which the inquiry itself is looking at, but to listen to some of the media reports and seeing the focus of the opposition, it is all about playing politics and scoring points. It does make you wonder about the purpose of public inquiries. Some people genuinely want to know the truth, but the reality is that most of the decisions made and the reasons for them have been in the public domain all along. And perhaps we should remember too that most of the decisions made had broad agreement across the parties in this chamber and in the various COVID committees, of which I was a member much of the time. It seems to me that most of us did use WhatsApp for, and many still do, is a way of chatting with friends and colleagues when we are not in the same room. We use it for throwing ideas around, brainstorming and whatever. Most of us did not expect and do not expect to see our WhatsApp messages published. So when the Conservative motion says, quote, deleting evidence that they knew would be required for the inquiry, I would suggest, one, there has been very little new evidence from WhatsApp or from anywhere else. Two, we all knew that Boris Johnson was an effing clown without Nicola Sturgeon telling us. Two, I remain unconvinced that the inquiry does need the WhatsApp messages and that they really add very much. And three, I'm not sure that many of us do think that our WhatsApp messages are likely to be required for any inquiry. So I just wonder how far we want to take this. I note the Lib Dems amendment wants more minutes of meetings, but why stop at minutes? Why not make a recording and publish every single conversation? Where would that take us, potentially, and eventually lead to a decision? Where do we draw the line? Labour say there's a culture of secrecy, but how much transparency do they want? Do they want Anas Sarwar and Hamza Yousaf's every conversation to be taped and published? We also have the suggestion that the COVID committee should be reconstituted, and I just wonder what the purpose of that would be. Most decisions made in Scotland around COVID were announced by the Scottish Government. They were then examined in detail by the COVID committee, who used expert advisers and a variety of witnesses. And these proposals were then approved by Parliament. Parliament even rejected some, like juryless trials. And that is not to mention media scrutiny at the time. Now, we're not having one, but two public inquiries going over these same decisions again. And it seems to me that relatively little real new information has been coming to light in recent days. Yes, we knew that Michael Gove, Boris Johnson, Nicola Sturgeon and Jean Freeman were politicians and included political angles in their decision-making. Well, that is hardly a huge revelation. Apparently, Michael Gove urged colleagues to protect and strengthen the union as a key aim during the pandemic. Well, that is part of his job description, after all. He was doing what it says in the tin. So let's not have fake shock and surprise that politicians are politicians. Now the Tories want a resurrected COVID committee to go over these same decisions for another time. First, the government and the experts. Second, the COVID committee already. Third, the media. Fourth, the UK inquiry. Fifth, the sixth inquiry, Scottish inquiry. Why do we want to look at the same decisions again and again? So what is the Tory motive? Perhaps to dig out some more juicy gossip? Maybe to see if anyone else used bad language? Going back to the purpose of public inquiries, what are we hoping for? As I said, I do think some people are genuinely looking for more information and explanations. Some families sadly lost loved ones during COVID and want to know if that could have been avoided. I myself lost my mother during the pandemic. She was living in a care home and visiting was severely restricted. And then there were only 20 allowed at her funeral. It was far from ideal, but I believe it was handled correctly. On the whole, I think we know why such restrictions were in place. Reasons were given at the time, and I think most of us accepted the logic and the thinking at that time. Now the inquiries are again looking at decisions that were made. It's all very easy to look back now and say that different decisions could and should have been made. Some would say that we all took the pandemic too seriously. We should have been more relaxed about it. There should have been fewer restrictions. But let's remember what we were seeing at the time. TV pictures of Italian hospitals overflowing and of the Chinese building new hospitals in a few weeks. And the general feeling at the time was that all governments, including the Scottish Government, had a duty to lead, a duty to act, and a duty to act quickly. People wanted action from the Scottish Government, and they got action from the Scottish Government. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Jim Fairley. Mr Green.
Benjamin Franklin once said, "They that give up essential liberty to purchase a little temporary safety deserve neither liberty nor safety." But that's exactly what we did in March 2020. Of course, the events which ensued led to the loss of more than 18,000 of our fellow Scots and has left physical and mental scars on anyone who survived it. And it's against that backdrop that I make my comments today. Back then, in this very chamber, I uttered the following words. "I believe that ministers are working earnestly to tackle this awful virus. However, people rightly expect transparency and the rationale behind those decisions because of the impact that they have in their lives," which makes the revelations of the UK COVID inquiry all the more galling, not to me, but to the families of the bereaved. Because any early consensus that we had that existed between political parties or between governments did not last very long, because it did not take long for political opportunism to creep in. Let's all forget, any suggestion of game playing during the pandemic, when asked, was met with incredulous denial. "How dare you suggest that? Of course I'm keeping all my notes. Of course I'll hand them all over." So the current furore around WhatsApp messages, the source of so much anger out there, is very well justified. Let's start with the basics. Why would you actually delete messages in the first place? Is it because A, you might be embarrassed by the content, or B, the messages might incriminate you some way in the future? Yeah. If it truly was Scottish Government official policy to habitually delete messages, and that's a defence we've heard ad nauseam all week from ministers, then why did some follow it to the letter and others not at all? Yeah. Why would it be government policy to delete messages in the first place? Why would you not want to keep a record of the pandemic? Not just messages. Minutes of meetings weren't taking place. The so-called gold command meetings, which we've heard so much about, were so gold the finance secretary didn't even know they existed. Yeah. And she was signing the checks. The cabinet was a talking shop, not a decision-making body, because clearly, from the evidence we've heard, challenging Nicola Sturgeon was met by a proverbial bullet. So let's think about that. If gold command didn't decide anything, if Cabinet didn't vote on anything, then how can anyone trust the entire decision-making process? We were all told, every one of us that passed those laws, that robust scientific evidence was driving the decisions. "Trust us," they said, and we did. But it turns out the clinical advisers were winging it as well. It's all there in black and white. This good old-fashioned rammy was conjured up by advisers. The endless UK versus us rhetoric that we heard, the holier-than-thou charade on our TV sets every single day. But what about the resulting damage it did to the economy, to mental health, to hospitality, to education, to our young people? That is why all of this is so important. It's not about who called whom a clown. Frankly, I could not care less. I sat in this Parliament day in, day out during the darkest days of COVID, including July 2020, when emails from John Swinney, just released by the inquiry, show that his office were more worried about Scotland's place in the EU than the 4,000 people who had already died of COVID. It is shameful, presiding officer. And it's shameful because of this. The trust that I gave, the trust that every MSP gave this government, that the public gave this government, has been shredded. Why? Because every government minister and every advisor knew fine well there would be a full inquiry into their actions. So what on earth were they thinking? They knew that conversations, no matter how trivial they seemed at the time, would be asked of them. Deleted, willfully or stupidly, perhaps both, it's hard to tell. Key evidence was destroyed. That's not unfortunate, it's not accidental, it was purposeful. Yeah. Jamie Dawson QC, in his forensic questioning this week, has exposed something which we all knew about in the bubble. The stench of cover-up was rife in the civil service, and it was rife in the government. It wasn't just idle chit-chat and gossip. If that was the case, then why were government WhatsApp groups advising people, everything is FOI-able, clear your chat? That is a phrase which will be a gut punch to anybody who lost a loved one. You can't separate the menial from the meaningful if the messages do not exist in the first place. Nicola Sturgeon has reinvented the very definition of delete by saying, I did not retain them. Well, the dictionary definition of delete, presiding officer, is to remove or to obliterate. The only thing that, which has been obliterated this week is her reputation. We all knew this day would come. Reckoning is never comfortable and it's never easy. But the public sacrificed so much for their liberty and their safety. The question is, given what we now know about this government, how many would do it again?
Thank you, Mr. Green. I now call Jim Fairley to be followed by Pauline McNeill. Mr. Fairley.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I have to say, when I read the Tory motion and then listened to Douglas Ross's open remarks, it actually saddened me and sickened me at where our politics in Scotland have been lowered to. My thoughts around the COVID inquiry that is ongoing and the Scottish inquiry that is to come will not just give the grieving families, but the whole country, the knowledge as to what was done correctly, what we need to learn so that from a future pandemic, which will inevitably happen, we'll have the means to be better prepared, that we're suitably funded, that we've got a better understanding of what worked well and how they could be improved. We'll have better science, data and modelling and use that data appropriately. We'll have a workforce and system fit to cope. To do that, Presiding Officer, we must look at let the inquiries look at the substance of the decisions that were being made at the time with the information available to the ministers at that time. In other words, let's avoid the snapshot headlines that are designed to misinform and allow the inquiries to do their job and give us that substantive information we need to be better prepared for the next time. No, I won't. I was very pleased to hear during my time in the COVID Recovery Committee that a new system of procurement had been or was being implemented to ensure that PPE contracts and supplies were being manufactured and supplied on a rolling just-in-time model to ensure availability on long-term resilience, as well as promoting Scottish domestic contractors fill that so that we have resilience in that system. It's a very welcome adaptation and a learning from what was clearly a mistake during the pandemic. We found out that Scotland is an absolute world leader in data collection, but not as good as using that data to best effect, so let's get that done better. We also learned through a committee inquiry about the harms that people suffered as a result of long COVID, which are very real and difficult for sufferers and families alike. I'd very much like to see where the government is as for the recommendations we made in that report so that long COVID patients and their families can see some light at the end of what has for them been a very long, dark tunnel. That leads me to my next point, societal reactions to any future pandemic and even more dangerous variant of what is currently circulating, because let's not forget this virus is very much still with us. Ultimately, it was that societal cooperation that made sure we got through this pandemic as well as we could have hoped for, and it will be that societal working again in the future that will be vital to make sure we can do it, whether it's 10 years, 50 years or 100 years down the line. Those lessons have to be our guiding star. And I want to say now and add my name to the record of everyone else who has expressed the sadness and condolences that I am no doubt we all feel for the bereaved families who lost loved ones to the virus or had the usual grieving process through other losses curtailed by the risk of the virus spreading. My mum died in May 2020 and her funeral was nothing more than putting her coffin in the ground, saying a few words from a priest that could barely be heard because of social distancing and going home. Those human interactions, the hugs, the tears, the reminiscing, all the things that we do as humans to help grieve were forbidden, and I have no doubt there will be long-lasting issues for many people who still suffer from that inability to grieve properly, and my heart goes out to each and every one of them. No, I won't. I saw Murdo Fraser talking about the loss of his parents over the weekend, and I extend that thought to him as well as to everyone else who has suffered. I am sure everyone in this chamber, after all, we are all human, regardless of the job we do, and we have all suffered from the effects and after-effects of one of nature's most deadly weapons. So it's for all these reasons that this motion saddened me, Presiding Officer, that we have a Tory party motion brought to the Chamber to try to preempt the findings of a formal set of inquiries which are costing millions of pounds, are being done diligently and with purpose to ensure we'll be better prepared for the next time. We must let the full course of those inquiries do their work so that we all get the benefit of the lessons to come from them.
We had an opposition member after member in the chamber yesterday decrying a Scottish Government motion looking at the opportunities of how we can improve the lot for all of the people through our relationship with the EU, saying it was a waste of money, a waste of parliamentary time. And yet they have all piled into this debate to try and make capital out of a horrendous situation that we had to collectively deal with. And by and large, those who were here agreed with the action. And yet, particularly members sitting over there, who constantly talk about both of Scotland's governments, refused to challenge the partying PPE fraud and scandal-ridden government of their Westminster party. And I say that hypocrisy just saddens rather than angers me in the context of the debate that we are having today. Now, I've watched some of the debates at the time of the pandemic starting to really require responses, and the conversations in this chamber around bed capacity in hospitals, and to everyone agreed that those beds needed to be released to deal with the pandemic. So I would ask all of those members who were here in this chamber at that time, what would they have done differently with the information that they had at that time, and they supported the government in trying to clear those beds in fear of the coming pandemic. That, presiding officer, is a crucial point I think we need to be considering. What did we do? Did we have the right information? How do we use the data we are so good at collecting? And we can do all that now with 2020 hindsight. We certainly couldn't do that at the height of the pandemic. If we allow the inquiries to do their jobs, presiding officer, perhaps we'll get those answers and ensure that societal trust I have spoken about, which our First Minister gained through monumental efforts of her and her entire cabinet, can be justified and repeated if we ever needed to do it again in our lifetime. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. I now call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan. Ms. McNeill.
I wrote an article in early 2020 about a constituent who had done everything right, isolated with her husband, followed all the other rules religiously. But her husband contracted COVID and he was struggling to breathe, and he was sent by ambulance to the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, where he was for 20 days. And she had to wait by the phone for a call each afternoon to learn of his progress. She wasn't allowed to visit. She wasn't offered Zoom or any way of seeing her husband. She couldn't phone in, such was the pressures on the nursing staff, understandably. Till one day she received a call to say that he died from COVID sitting alone in her home. Imagine the trauma of losing your husband of 20 years. You had no idea he was actually dying till you got the call. There was no one present due to the restrictions. No follow-up, no bereavement, and no formal counselling until I got involved as our MSP. I vowed then, as I'm going to do now, to seek answers for people like her. She won't get a specific answer to this. But what she is entitled to are broad, bigger answers to the approach that was taken, because I'm aware that other hospitals and English hospitals, and I'm not clear myself why this was the case, did allow some families in PPE to go and visit their families. It is only by examining the circumstances of the COVID period and examining the decisions that we took and the principles that we applied, who took these decisions, how these decisions were recorded, that we'll have any chance of understanding the lessons we need to learn from that horrible period. Why the chief scientist said in his evidence that the government ignored their own advice, particularly in relation to schools, has to be answered. And furthermore, doctors were clear to me that there was a policy during COVID of not referring those over age 65 to hospitals. You're still to get an answer from ministers when they were questioned. I felt they were evasive, unable to answer a critical question that goes to the very heart of how human rights were applied during the COVID period. Who took this decision? Who took the decision on the do not resuscitate policy? These are answers we all desperately need. And that is why we do require to examine how decisions were made and how they were recorded. I mean, Bob Doris, in his contribution, I have to say to Bob, if he is still listening, who would be in the shoes of the former First Minister or Jason Leach, the National Clinical Director? I felt for them all during that period because they had heavy decisions to make, but they were the people in charge making life and death decisions. So we must be able to examine every single decision that they made that resulted in serious decisions about the size of weddings, the size of funerals, health service arrangements and what I've just spoken about. They must be accountable, and that means they must be prepared to provide all the relevant evidence. While thousands of families across Scotland grieve the loss of a loved one, people dealt with mental health issues by being restricted. It's really important to look back. People at the top, the First Minister, government ministers and officials, it seems, were deliberately and purposely deleting vital information. And it looks like we'll never see this. But what concerns me is it's not just random. It does seem quite organised the way this was done. And for me, a central question for government is, these deletions, where did this policy come from? Why did some officials delete all their messages? Some officials deleted some of their messages. Some have kept all of their messages. I mean, why is this such a mess? Why was there no policy? And I do ask the civil service, because in my time, I've always understood that there is a role of the civil service to listen into government ministers, to protect government ministers and the administration. All notion of this seems to have completely gone. How can we judge the handling of all the decisions if we're not to be provided with this information on the WhatsApp deletion policy or the relaying advice to ministers by the back door by private accounts? Is not in the spirit of the Public Records Act, not in the spirit of freedom of information, and it's not in the spirit of what we were told back then in 2020. There must be proper record keeping, and there must, I would have thought, there at least be one cabinet decision discussion around this. I mean, quite honestly, who does delete their messages at bedtime? I'm sorry. If you're doing it, you're doing it for a reason, and people aren't stupid. It doesn't sound credible. And that's what the National Clinical Director and other ministers... I'm sorry, I don't have time. I would love to give way on this. I'm not out to specifically criticise anyone who I know had a heavy burden, but come on, really, give us some evidence that we can believe, give us some answers that do sound credible, because the accusation is that it was done on an industrial scale, and that is a worry for this Parliament, and it's a worry for the law. What we've heard about the gatekeeping on freedom of information clearly exposes that it's not worth the paper it's written on, and as work to be done at a future date. The culture of cover-up was present long before COVID, on the Queen Elizabeth Hospital University scandal, on the ferry fiasco, and on the steel scandal that led the way to a lack of transparency during the most important period of Scotland's modern times. We must do better than that. And I call on everyone to cooperate with this inquiry, give the public the answers they deserve.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. I now call Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Ros McCall. Ms Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And today I speak in support of the Scottish Government amendment to the UK COVID Inquiry in Scotland motion as we consider the decision-making process and outcomes of the pandemic response in our nation. As we know, Presiding Officer, the COVID-19 pandemic has been the most serious public health crisis of our time, affecting millions of lives and livelihoods across the world. In Scotland, we've faced many challenges and difficulties, but we've also shown resilience, solidarity and compassion in the face of adversity. Individuals and communities right across Scotland stepped up to look after each other and include our children in that. While our young people did miss some school lessons, they learned some really big life lessons about the things that really matter, looking after family, friends, neighbours and strangers too. And I trust that the comfort of human touch and the value of hugging each other tight will never be lost to them. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government was guided by the best available scientific evidence and advice, available at that point in time without the benefit of hindsight, and acted swiftly and decisively to protect the health and well-being of Scotland's people. Scotland pursued a zero COVID strategy aiming to eliminate the virus entirely in 2020, and lifted lockdown rules more gradually than the rest of the UK, following a cautious and careful approach. Testing capacity was expanded, ensuring that everyone with symptoms of a respiratory infection, including COVID-19, could access a test. A successful vaccination programme was rolled out, offering the vaccine to every eligible person and providing boosters to all who needed them. The inquiry will rightly examine the early challenges around guidance, personal protective equipment and care home admissions. But as Jean Freeman told the inquiry, you cannot magic out of thin air appropriate buildings, appropriate kit and skilled individuals. The learnings that flow from the current inquiry will support future governments to improve planning and offer better protection to us all. Throughout the pandemic, Presiding Officer, our First Minister kept the public well informed, communicating clearly and transparently about the rules and restrictions, the risks and benefits, and the rationale and evidence behind decision-making. Various channels and platforms were used, such as the daily briefings, social media, websites, leaflets and posters, to reach out to different audiences and communities. It took its toll. The public could see it in their face. But it was absolutely necessary. And the Scottish Government is rightly taking the time to listen to the views and feedback of the public through a range of consultations and surveys. Recognising the pandemic as a global challenge that requires a coordinated and cooperative response has also been key, hence the need to work closely and collaboratively with other UK nations, as well as international partners, to share information, resources and best practices. Yet, the different circumstances and needs of each nation must also be respected, and it is right for Scotland's government to exercise devolved powers and responsibilities and tailored responses to specific situations in Scotland. Sadly, the Tory benches disagree, but then that's to be expected. Presiding Officer, we cannot be complacent or self-congratulatory, and the Scottish Government acknowledges there were mistakes and shortcomings, committing to learning from these and improving, and welcoming the UK COVID inquiry to Scotland, because conducting a thorough and independent investigation into the pandemic response across our nations is really, really important. And the Scottish Government must continue cooperating fully and openly with the inquiry, providing evidence and documents and answering questions from the inquiry panel. Today's debate feels really premature. And as we've heard, the independence of the inquiry is central, and politicians attempting to preempt the conclusions is really unhelpful. No, I won't. Instead, we should let the inquiry get on with its work, as we've heard, and act accordingly when the recommendations are released, preparing to accept any criticisms and suggestions for improvement. I trust the inquiry will also recognise the efforts and achievements of the Scottish Government and the people of Scotland in tackling the pandemic, identifying strengths as well as weaknesses and drawing together future lessons and implications. Presiding Officer, the COVID-19 pandemic is not over yet. We are still living with the virus and we still face uncertainties and challenges ahead. We need to remain vigilant and adaptable and to continue to follow the public health guidance and advice. And we need to support each other and look after ourselves, showing kindness and compassion to those who have been affected by the pandemic, because grieving families are at the absolute heart of this, and it's affected all of us. In closing, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government must continue to do everything in its power to protect the health and lives of people in Scotland, support the recovery and renewal of our society and economy, remain transparent and accountable to the public, and strive to engage and involve people in the decision-making process. Cooperation and collaboration with other UK nations and the international community will also remain key as we continue to contribute to the global fight against the pandemic. Let's focus where we should be focusing. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Callaghan. I now call Ros McCall to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Ms McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Everyone I've spoken to recently is dismayed about the COVID-19 inquiry revelations. I've been told many stories of how decisions made in this place have had a detrimental effect on the health of someone, either themselves or someone they love. One lady, a former nurse who worked through the pandemic, is now living with long COVID. She has difficulty breathing, which makes her tired. And that means she has limited time where her energy is sufficient to do what most people would consider basic tasks. So even walking to the local shop can be a challenge. Not only has her health been negatively impacted by this, but she's also been dismissed from the nursing job she loves. and she freely admits there was nothing else they could do as she simply no longer could do the job. She now spends most of her time in her house for fear she'll simply run out of energy at the wrong time. She's lost her health, her livelihood and her freedom. Presiding officer, she's been failed. Another person has shared with me the downward trajectory of her grandmother, an elderly lady living in a care home who couldn't understand why her loving family, who regularly visited, simply stopped coming. The effects, the lack of this simple, familiar human contact had been disturbing. An otherwise healthy but elderly lady became fragile and withdrawn as the feelings of rejection manifested themselves in depression. No number of visits after lockdown eased repaired the mental health damage to this lady. What should have been a resting and peaceful last few years became a disturbing descent of frailty and distress. Presiding officer, she was failed. And I have previously spoken in this chamber about my own experiences due to the changes to healthcare provision that came about as a direct consequence of the COVID-19 decisions. Cancer treatment provisions for some simply stopped overnight. Now, I knew that as a global pandemic had hit our nation, certain sacrifices by everyone would have to be made. And as a family, we knew that this meant a change in healthcare priorities was essential. So considering the type of cancer and how slim the chances were of extending any quality of life rather than duration of life, we accepted the changes as graciously as anyone could, knowing that death was certain and imminent. Presiding officer, we were failed. We were all failed because even though it was presumed, to find out that decisions made imposing sacrifices on the people of Scotland were made even in part for political gain belittles the trust and faith this country put in this SNP government. To have former Liz Lloyd, the former First Minister's Chief of Staff, state, "My reason for setting a time frame for them to answer us on furlough is purely political, especially as we expect the answer to be no, it looks awful for them." And then to follow that up with, "I think I just want a good old-fashioned rammy so I can think about something other than sick people," is absolutely disgusting. To have Nicola Sturgeon suggested that the Professor of Public Health, Deva Shariar, message privately about proposals on managing the next steps of the pandemic, and then with the former First Minister replying, "Don't worry about protocol," and continue, "You can send it to me privately," before divulging a private SNP email address, is frankly dishonourable. To have Nicola Sturgeon advise that nothing would be off limits for the public COVID inquiry when she said, "I think if you understand statutory public inquiries, you would know that even if I wasn't prepared to give that assurance, which for the avoidance of doubt I am, then I wouldn't have the ability." And to have Ken Thompson, the then Director General for Strategy and External Affairs, write that plausible deniability are my middle names, and to continually refer to messages being FOIable highlights just how concerning the content of the messages were to decision makers. Knowing that deleting messages would hide FOI information and blatantly advising people to do so can only lead us to ask the following questions. What was in the deleted messages? Why was the former First Minister's assurances not met in full, because they should have been? And how on earth can the general public ever believe this government again?
Thank you, Mr. McCall. And I now call Stuart McMillan, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. And Mr. McMillan is joining us remotely. Mr. McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, first of all, I have listened to the full debate so far, and there were some excellent contributions, including from Alex Rowley and Bob Doris. But the line in the Tory motion in front of us, and I quote it, calls for the Scottish Government, calls for the Parliament's COVID-19 Recovery Committee to be reconstituted for the purpose of providing parliamentary scrutiny of evidence revealed by the inquiry, I think says more about the partisan politics than actually getting to the substance of the debate. The reality for anyone who cares about the reality is that this debate is just an attempt by the Conservatives to actually distract from the complete chaos that's engulfing their own party in Westminster. Presiding officer, every constituent has a story to tell with regards to COVID-19. Every single member of this Parliament has their story to tell with regards to the COVID-19 pandemic. And the public are engaging with the UK COVID-19 inquiry, and they will make up their own minds as more information comes to light and when the final report is published. And as we know, there will be the Scottish inquiry, and I welcome the fact that the Scottish Government established the first public inquiry in the UK to examine the response to COVID-19 in December 2021, ahead of the UK Government commencing the UK-wide public inquiry. Now, the inquiries will help identify what could have been done better and to improve government decision-making in a pandemic to save lives and prevent suffering in the future. And as we've also heard today, the Scottish Government will examine and consider closely the recommendations that both the Scottish and UK public inquiries will make. However, I'm sure that we can all unite in our hopes that we never, ever have to face such a pandemic again in our lifetimes. Ultimately, the current COVID inquiry is performing an important job. So for the Tories to attempt to do the inquiry's job does a disservice to those who lost loved ones and also who want answers. And it does appear to me, and I know to others, that the Tories' attempt, their attempts to be judge, jury and also executioner on one government, when they consistently remind us that Scotland has two governments, says it all about their naked politicking and such an important issue. I am firmly of the belief that the current and future inquiry need to undertake their roles independently of political interference. I also welcome the fact that the First Minister's comments last week that he has commissioned an externally led review into the Scottish Government's use of mobile messaging apps and non-corporate technology. I'm sitting opposite as one of the members who served on the harassment committee in the last session. It's been touched upon already in this debate. I recognise the political game that's actually been played today. And it seems to me that that the Tories want this parliamentary session to end the same way as the last session did. And quite frankly, presiding officer, it wasn't the Parliament's finest hour with the leaks and other activities that came from that committee. If the Tories are suggesting for 1 minute that the current independent inquiry isn't up to the job, then I think it says more about them than the inquiry itself. Now, one of the points that has been raised with me before and also during the current inquiry is that concerning the billions of pounds of public money given to businesses that actually have links to the Conservative Party. And I'm sure there'll be public support for a public inquiry into this point alone. But the level of alleged fraudulent activity, it puts the ferry situation here into perspective. And as the Tories have been leading on committee inquiry after committee inquiry into the ferries, and I'm sure they'd be happy to support a public inquiry into the billions of pounds that have been given to the companies with Tory donor links. And information before and during this inquiry seems to highlight fraud on an industrial scale. 10 billion of PPE costs written off and use of the VIP lane was ruled as being, and I quote, unlawful by the courts. Now, not to forget the actual deals to businesses owned by Tory donors. Now, we are seeing a high-profile case now under investigation. And I agree with the comments from the Deputy First Minister earlier in calling for the establishment of a UK COVID Corruption Commissioner. In addition to this was the partying that was going on in Downing Street, and it was Boris Johnson and Rishi Sunak who went to court to try to conceal their messages from the inquiry. The public anger and frustration is clear with these examples alone. I could also include the fact that it was the UK government who spent their time plotting against independence in the middle of a global pandemic, and some will agree with this action, and others will certainly disagree with it, of course. Something also, dealing with a pandemic should have been the sole purpose of government, irrespective of Parliament and who was in power. The public deserved absolutely no less. Saying also, as I'm about to conclude my contribution, it's important that the public are fully aware of the following with regards to the current inquiry. The Scottish Government's messages handed over to the UK Government 19 inquiry will be starkly different to those of Westminster politicians. The Scottish Government has ensured that the Government has released 28,000 messages to it. And when it comes to the First Minister's witness statement, it includes reams of WhatsApp messages which are unredacted. That is, of course, in very stark contrast to the actions of a Prime Minister who not only dragged the inquiry through the court, but has refused to hand over his own WhatsApp messages. President, I will be voting against the Tory motion tonight, as it delivers nothing, absolutely nothing, to help families of those who sadly lost a loved one during the pandemic. Let the two inquiries do their work. The living and also the deceased deserve that.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. And we now move to closing speeches. I call on Michael Mara to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The vital precursor to this debate, mentioned I think only once, is the First Minister's concession to the COVID inquiry that the SNP government's handling of vital evidence has been, and I quote, frankly poor. He did offer an unreserved apology. And the real heart of the debate is whether that poor practice is actually reflective of an endemic culture. Labour contends that it is. That this is just the most egregious example of 17 years of secrecy and cover-up. And we are right to worry as a country about the degradation of our governing institutions. Ensuring that those are maintained is a key and critical function of Parliament. The evidence of recent days gleaned from the past SNP ministers has been something else entirely. It's provoked real and visceral anger on behalf of COVID bereaved families. These are their words. Nicola Sturgeon projected a daily image of sincerity in wanting to do right by the people of Scotland during the pandemic. That carefully crafted image has been left shattered by the hands of Ms Sturgeon herself, the words of the families themselves. The families speaking this morning before the evidence predicted the sorrow and the tears that they knew would follow. They are not moved by it. They are not convinced by it. It merely compounds the betrayal that they feel. And colleagues have been right to highlight the lasting effects of the pandemic. Long COVID, a further derailed NHS, which this government has singularly failed to help recover, the impact on school attainment and school attendance, profound cultural shifts in our behaviours and our economy. Alec Rowley rightly set out that a parliamentary committee could focus on the genuine future changes that would arise from these public inquiries. But Mr Rowley rightly, I believe, shared Jackie Bailey's view that this Parliament's Scottish Government's Handling of Harassment Complaints Committee, otherwise known as the Salmond Committee, found it impossible to extract evidence from this government. It was deliberately obstructed, it was misled, and nobody could seemingly recall anything. This is a culture. It is endemic. It is pervasive, and it is insidious. The Salmond scandal, the Lochaber smelter, Ferguson Marine and the Ferries debacle. The ministers on the front bench calling these lies. The Ferguson Marine and Ferries debacle, Presiding Officer. No minutes, forgotten conversations, missing documents. We have heard it time and time again. Presiding Officer, the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital scandal, backing the cover-up rather than backing the families. A growing queue of information commissioners, past and present, lining up to denounce the Scottish Government's handling of freedom of information. All of this does matter, and the WhatsApp messages being deleted does matter too. It didn't happen by accident. It was a calculated, deliberate attempt to destroy vital evidence to a public inquiry. Everybody knows that Boris Johnson is a clown. Nobody thinks that of the former First Minister. This was deliberate and it was considered. And SNP backbenchers have said that these messages aren't they just chit-chat and gossip. The evidence is clear that they are not. Nicola Sturgeon and Liz Lloyd developing policy on WhatsApp. The First Minister deleted the exchanges, but thankfully others did not get the memo. So instead we get to see the evidence. It was up to the inquiry to decide what was relevant, hence do not destroy notices that were issued. Nicola Sturgeon was asked again and again this morning whether she had deleted messages. She obfuscated, she prevaricated, but eventually Jamie Dawson KC winnowed away the chaff. Yes, she said. Yes. That matters more than the tears. And it does matter, because the message we have seen tells us, as Polly McNeill put it, that we must be able to examine every single decision that was made, and they must be accountable. And of the few messages we have seen by those ministers who did not get the memo, or who did not obey the do not destroy instruction, whether by mistake or honest commitment, we get to see the culture of the relationship between ministers and the civil service, which has become entirely inappropriate. Former ministers and former senior servants aghast at the blurred lines between this government and the civil service. And that matters too, Presiding Officer, and I'll tell you why. Think of the El Jamel scandal in Tayside at the moment, where we have a senior medical officer involved in that situation, and the quite apparent to those people, the lack of separation between the government and civil servants in that regard. And it's fundamentally betraying the trust of the people that are involved in that scandal that they can get the true answers that they require. So that is the legacy of an... No, thank you. I'm in my final few moments, otherwise I would be happy to do so. That is the legacy of an endemic culture of secrecy and cover-up. We must have a COVID corruption commissioner in the UK to get to the heart of the toxic consequences of the Tory government. But here we require change too, and we get it with a new government.
I have one online, but I'll take Ms Bailey first. Point of order.
But forgive me, Presiding Officer. Keith Brown accused Michael Mara of lying, and he repeated it when challenged. Do you consider it appropriate for him to apologise?
I thank Ms Bailey for her contribution. I did not hear that. All I can say is I didn't hear it. I'm not saying it wasn't said. I'm just saying I didn't hear it. Obviously, all members know that they are required, and could we not have further sedentary cross-bench discussion whilst I am speaking? I would remind all members of the requirement to treat each other with courtesy and respect at all times, and members are quite well aware of the rules around language in this chamber. I now call Bob Dorris for a point of order, and Bob Dorris is joining us online.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On a point of order, earlier in the debate, Polly McNeill MSP, I think, inadvertently, and I do mean it inadvertently, suggested I was not following the debate when she name-checked me during her contribution in relation to ministerial accountability. I'm not sure what mechanism exists other than trying to intervene on said member, but when one intervenes remotely, that is not registered on the official reports. To any person watching the contributions this afternoon, they would inadvertently think that as a member of this parliament, I had made a contribution and a speech during a very serious debate and then not followed the rest of the debate. That would be wholly disrespectful to the victims of COVID and their families and everyone else with a key interest in this debate. I know it's now on the record, Presiding Officer, that I did follow the debate, but is there any other procedures where this can be rectified in the future so that I'm not actually taking up the time of yourself and the Chamber to put these matters on the record in such a way?
Perhaps, Ms McNeill, I could deal with Mr Dorris's point of order first, and then I will come to Ms McNeill. What I would say to Mr Dorris is that is not a matter for the Chair. The Member has made his point, and the matter is on the record. I call Polly McNeill for a point of order.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I just want to put on the record, in no way in my contribution did I intend in any possible way to infer that Bob Dorris was not listening to it. It's something you say in a debate if the person's still listening. That's the only remark that I made. And I'm honestly quite astounded that a member would come on and make that point. If the point is being made, Presiding Officer, that to safeguard Bob Dorris's point, that he wishes it to be known that he watched the debate throughout, then that's something entirely different. But I hope the Presiding Officer would accept my response that I was in no way being disrespectful to him and never would be. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. What I would say also to Ms McNeill is that is not a matter for the Chair, but Ms McNeill has helpfully clarified the matter, which will also be on the record. And I now intend to call George Adam, Minister, to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At this point, Presiding Officer, I wish to echo and reiterate the important points made by the Deputy First Minister in our opening remarks, notably the need to never never lose sight of the impact of the pandemic for people, and particularly those who lost loved ones. During the debate, there was much said about what was how we went about the business, but one of the things I want to mention at this point as well that the Deputy First Minister said during her opening remarks was that's why the First Minister has not only apologised for any hurt caused by the Scottish Government prior handling of requests for the inquiry, but he also announced an external-led review on the use of mobile messaging apps and non-corporate technology. And at this point, I'd like to go on about, and as most people have spoken during this debate, about the impact on families and in our communities across Scotland. And most of the speakers spoke about this in particular. Ruth Maguire, in a very timely and interesting intervention, brought up the fact that she felt everything was just a wee bit too much. And the families themselves, listening to this debate, would think that this was probably not what they wanted to hear. And I think she's right about that. Jim Fairley, as we all know, everybody has a COVID story. And Jim Fairley talked about his mum's funeral and how that meant to him. And other members mentioned that as well, what affected them. Stuart McMillan talked about all our constituents having stories, and that's true. And for me, and I wasn't going to mention it because I've mentioned it in a previous debate about my mother-in-law, Rosemary, having COVID and dying in the RAH in Paisley. But I think everything's been so personal in this debate that we all, and I want people to understand that when I'm making these decisions and I'm moving forward, we've all got something that's happened to us during that. And Rosemary died in 2021 when she had COVID. And I remember seeing her when she was going to the ambulance. We couldn't go down to the house. We knew that she was going to the ambulance, and we knew I had a feeling we'd never see her again at that stage. Now, things became difficult for us because not only was, and we've heard this from other members when they've spoken of not being able to see their, I think Pauline McNeill brought it up with regards to not seeing their loved ones, being able to see them because of the COVID restrictions. And it was even doubly for us, because Stacey, as you all know, has multiple sclerosis and therefore it's an autoimmune disease and therefore has our immunity is compromised. Now, I had the decision to make there. At that time, things had got a wee bit looser and you were able to go and see the individuals. I had to make a decision there of losing one of the most important women in my life, or two of them. Now, so I just want people to know that none of us here in the Scottish Government take this lightly. We all have these stories. We all know how families, and we feel for the families and everything that's happened to them as well. And some of the contributions that we've had from members today highlighted that. John Mason took us back to the dark days of when we went into lockdown and how difficult everything was. He took us back and mentioned how we never knew this Parliament didn't even have a process to actually continue business, which quickly happened during that process and was very important for us. And Kevin Stewart again spoke about the families themselves and how they are always the most important ones in this. And, Presiding Officer, the pandemic presented exceptional pressures for every single one of us. And I'm particularly grateful for the work of our civil servants, scientific advisers and clinicians who, for supporting this government to make decisions that were informed by the best available advice during the most challenging of circumstances. It is important that we learn lessons from our collective experience of the pandemic, and this process of reflection and learning will help us prepare better for any future emergencies. Presiding Officer, can I just make these points at the moment? Presiding Officer, our approach to government understands and embraces the need to make information available about policies and decisions and to be accountable to this Parliament and to the public and to listen to all voices. We have and will continue to work to ensure that the lessons from the pandemic are learned. And that is why that during the pandemic, the previous First Minister, members of the Cabinet, public health officials stood day after day in St Andrew's House providing information and responses to the pandemic and answering questions about the approach. Indeed, the former First Minister led over 250 media briefings between March 2020 and the end of 2021, where she answered questions about the Scottish Government's management of the pandemic. During the pandemic, we understood the critical importance of ensuring that people were clear about the decisions being made the reason for the sacrifices they were being asked to make and the risk to public health posed by the virus. And we all know it was an exceptional time, particularly for Scottish Government ministers and officials who worked round the clock to respond to the global pandemic. We will all remember how scared we all were then, how we didn't know what the virus was and how it would impact on us and all of our families, and our jobs and the economy. People will remember even the symptoms that we were first told about changed as more evidence was gathered about this new disease. The government's aim was to suppress transmission of the COVID virus, to save lives, to save jobs and keep people safe. Exceptional times required exceptional measures, and this Parliament had to consider legislation that was totally unprecedented. This, of course, included the UK Coronavirus Bill, which this Parliament supported unanimously, and the subsequent Scottish Emergency Bills, of course, that many sets of regulations that changed the way we all lived our lives. The Scottish Government did not make decisions and measures in isolation of the impacts that could have. While still in lockdown in April 2020, the Scottish Government set out its approach to making future decisions on its pandemic response. This was to marshal the harms of the pandemic, including the effects of any restrictions that were imposed in the four harms category. Direct health from the virus, wider health harms, societal harms and economic harms. Decisions made would involve an assessment of the impact proposed measures on each of these harms, therefore ensuring that these measures were proportionate and necessary to control the spread of the virus. As the Deputy First Minister has already set out, the Scottish Government is cooperating fully with both the Scottish and UK COVID inquiries. I would remind the Chamber that over 19,000 documents have been handed over to the UK inquiry, and the Scottish Government, we have already provided nearly 28,000 messages. I'm just in closing at the moment. Thank you very much. And as we explained, because this is a very important debate and I have to ensure that we get our point across, because there's been much said during this debate. And as explained during the inquiry last week, if political pressures were used, it wasn't for constitutional reasons. It was based on those...
Members, we will listen to the member who has the floor, who's the Minister, please. Thank you.
It
Minister.
Was based on the four harms. For example, ensuring that furlough was available to save jobs during lockdown in Scotland and making sure that our people were paid. Politics was not at the forefront of ministers' minds during the pandemic. It was the suppression of a
Minister,
new...
Please assume, Minister, please assume your seat. I've already said to the Conservative benches that they should have the courtesy to listen to the member who has the floor, which is the Minister for Parliamentary Business. Minister, please resume.
Ministers' minds during the pandemic was on the suppression of the new deadly virus. Should different decisions have been taken? Possibly yes. But we can say that about many decisions with the benefit of hindsight. All at the time of the pandemic, elected members of the government took the best decisions they could with the evidence they had and with the best intentions for the people of Scotland at the times to the forefront. How many in this chamber at that time were glad it was not them having to make these decisions day in, day out? Presiding officer, there's been a lot of talk today, and that's not grounded in reality. Some opposition members have chosen not to just use hindsight, but to rewrite history of a time where people not just in Scotland and in the UK, but across the world, were scared of a deadly virus. And can I say, for Scotland at least, those changes took the best decisions they could, those in charge took the best decisions they could at all times and made the right decisions.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Murdo Fraser to close and respond to the debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 9 minutes, please.
Well, thank you, Presiding Officer. And I think the words "not grounded in reality" sum up the contribution we've just heard from the Minister. Now, there's been a wide range of issues covered in the debate this afternoon, so let me try and bring together some of the threads and the different contributions we've heard and sum up the key points made in our motion and in the debate. John Mason made a better shift than anybody on his front bench in terms of defending the Scottish Government's approach. But the key point I don't think he understood or didn't address is that our concern here is about transparency. because in line with much else done with this SNP government, information has had to be dragged out of them in connection with the decisions made in relation to the COVID-19 pandemic. And what has been dragged out has made dismal reading. There is a culture of cover-up and secrecy in this government, and we should all be grateful to the UK COVID inquiry, and in particular to Jamie Dawson KC and his team for the excellent work they've done shining a light on the darker workings of this government. What has been revealed is that public and Parliament were misled by the former First Minister Nicola Sturgeon and other members of the government about information that would be provided to the inquiry. Now, both the Deputy First Minister and Mr Radden made great play of the fact that 28,000 messages were handed over to the inquiry. Matt Hancock, the former UK Health Secretary, handed over himself over 100,000 messages, which puts into context the figure of 28,000. Now, let's remind ourselves what Nicola Sturgeon said when she was asked if anything would be off limits to the inquiry back in August 2021. She said this: "I think if you understand statutory public inquiries, you would know that even if I wasn't prepared to give that assurance, which for the avoidance of doubt I am, then I wouldn't have that ability." So we can take that as a clear promise that all relevant information will be provided. And the then Deputy First Minister, John Swinney, said something very similar. And when asked about the same issue, the current First Minister said this: "Any material that is asked for, WhatsApp messages, emails, Signal messages, Telegram messages or whatever, will absolutely be handed over to the COVID inquiries and handed over to them in full." So there we have it, from the former First Minister, the former Deputy First Minister and the current First Minister, clear and unequivocal undertakings that all information will be handed over. And yet now we know that that was not done. That promise was not kept. We now know that Nicola Sturgeon deleted all her WhatsApp messages during the pandemic period, confirmed in a note to the UK inquiry. And we also learned that John Swinney did not retain his messages and had an auto-delete function on. Now, Mr Swinney yesterday claimed he had been adhering to the Scottish Government's mobile messaging policy introduced in November 2021, urging the deletion of WhatsApp messages after 30 days. But crucially, this was after undertakings had been given by Nicola Sturgeon that all relevant messages would be preserved and provided. Now, we've heard in this debate from SNP speakers that relevant information in these messages was recorded elsewhere. It was transferred onto other systems of recording. But without the original WhatsApp messages, we simply cannot know if that is the case, and nor can the UK COVID inquiry. We, they and the Scottish public are left trying to piece together the information from that which was properly recorded. I will have the member's brief.
Alec Cohampton.
I'm grateful to the member giving way. Does he share my concern at the incongruity between what we heard from Nicola Sturgeon today, saying that she has been routinely deleting all of her private messages on the advice of civil servants since 2007, and the reality that the committee he and I served on in the Salmond inquiry actually received WhatsApp messages from Nicola Sturgeon herself?
Myrtle Fraser.
It's a very fair point for Mr Cole Hamilton. Indeed, I heard today the former First Minister, Alex Salmond, saying there was no policy in the Scottish Government to delete WhatsApp messages, despite assertions made yesterday to the inquiry by Mr Swinney. And not every minister has gone down the route of deleting their WhatsApps. Yesterday, the former Finance Secretary, Kate Forbes, said she had retained all of hers, and she was not even aware of the deletion policy until it was drawn to her attention in January 2022. And we also learned from Kate Forbes that she was surprised that crucial Gold Command meetings were not minuted during the pandemic, despite the importance of the matters being discussed. And even more concerning, Presiding Officer, is the position of the current First Minister, Hamza Yousaf. In October 2023, he told the COVID inquiry he had deleted all his messages for security reasons. When asked by the media about the same issue on October the 30th, he denied press reports he had been deleting his WhatsApps and said he had retained them all and would hand them over to the inquiry. On November the 2nd, he made a second submission to the inquiry, handing over his WhatsApps, which were on a phone handset he no longer used but had been able to recover. And then on November the 16th, he made a third submission to the inquiry, claiming his WhatsApps covering the critical four-month period at the start of the pandemic had been completely wiped out. And then on January the 25th, he told Parliament he had handed over his messages to the inquiry, despite and contrary to what he previously said. Now, presiding officer, if you're finding all this as difficult to follow as I am, that just points to the chaos and confusion at the heart of the Scottish Government and the weaknesses in their record-keeping. And that's just from government ministers. What we've seen from senior civil servants and senior advisers was them joking with each other about the need to delete their messages, particularly so they could not be recovered under freedom of information. That was a deliberate attempt at cover-up, to deprive the public of a view into the decision-making process in government, which must be unforgivable and may even be criminal. And no wonder the Scottish Government wanted to cover up what was being discussed, given all that we have heard. Despite claims from Nicola Sturgeon that decisions were not being made on WhatsApp, we now know that wasn't true, because according to what we heard from Liz Lloyd last week, key choices about the number of individuals allowed at weddings were being settled, it appears, in a WhatsApp exchange between the former First Minister and her Chief of Staff. Not a decision taken by Cabinet or based, it seems, on any sound scientific or medical advice. And we also saw Nicola Sturgeon suggesting that the Professor of Public Health, Devi Sridhar, should message her privately with advice to her private SNP email address, which would not be subject to freedom of information. But worst of all, presiding officer, we now know the Scottish Government were pursuing a political agenda and advancing the cause of independence throughout the pandemic period. As both Ros McCall and Pam Gozo reminded us, we learned last week from Liz Lloyd that she wanted to start a good old-fashioned rammy with the UK Government because she was tired of thinking about sick people. And that just sums up what was behind the Scottish Government's approach here. More interested in independence, more interested in picking fights with Westminster than being concerned for those suffering and dying here in Scotland. Presiding officer, we know that in June 2020, the Cabinet agreed to consider restarting their push for Scottish independence. On that very same day, in a press conference, the First Minister denied suggestions that she could be using the pandemic for politics, saying it would be a betrayal of the people of Scotland to campaign for independence during COVID. But the very same day, that is exactly what they were discussing at the Cabinet, presiding officer. If that's not a deceitful position, I don't know what is. And I would say this. Yes, of course, I'll give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
Just on the point, I wonder if Murdo Fraser saw and listened to Michael Gove's evidence on Monday. When Michael Gove talked about a Cabinet paper he had taken to the UK Government Cabinet about the benefits of the union and using the pandemic to promote that. Now, if he's going to be even-handed here, which I'm sure he will be, surely he cannot criticise one government on the one hand, but not recognise what that looks like to the public. Surely that would be a fair thing to recognise, that the attack line he's giving is exactly what Michael Gove admitted to on Monday.
Murdo Fraser?
No. What Mr Gove was doing was responding to the politicisation of the pandemic by the SNP government. That's what he was doing. But the worst example we have of politicisation came out this afternoon. And Mr Adam should listen to this, and Jamie Green referred to it in his contribution. Because this afternoon, we learnt from the inquiry that an email was sent from the Deputy First Minister's account on the 20th of July 2020, expressing, and I quote, extreme concern about putting Spain on the quarantine list because, and this is a direct quote from the Deputy First Minister's email account, because the Spanish government will conclude it is entirely political. They won't forget there is a real possibility they will never approve EU membership for an independent Scotland as a result. They will never approve EU membership for an independent Scotland as a result. So there we have it, presiding officer, in black and white. The prospects of an independent Scotland joining the EU were more important than public health considerations when it came to decision-making on COVID by this government.
Mr Fraser, so could you please bring your remarks to a close? Please, Mr Fraser, your time is up.
Presiding officer. What all this tells us, presiding officer, if we need a proper and further investigation into all the concerns we've heard today. Yes, the inquiries will do their work, as SNP members have called for, but it could be years before we see a report from the UK COVID inquiry, and the Scottish one is at an even earlier stage. In the meantime, let's see the COVID-19 committee in this Parliament re-established, and let the current First Minister, the former First Minister and the former Deputy First Minister refer themselves to the independent adviser on the ministerial code. That is the way the COVID bereaved families and the public can get the answers they deserve. And that is the way we will all get a better understanding of what was going on in government at the time that they are so desperate to try and cover up. That is a point made in our motion today, as I would urge the Parliament
to
agree. Thank you,
Mr. President.
Thank you.
That concludes the debate on UK COVID-19 inquiry revelations, and it is now time to move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is consideration of business motion 12020 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. I call on George Adam, Minister, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you. And no member has asked to speak on the motion. So the question is that motion 12020 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of 7 Parliamentary Bureau motions. I again ask Minister George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move motions 12021 on approval of SI, 12022 and 12023 on approval of SSIs, 12024 and 12025 on approval of laid documents, 12026 on designation of lead committee and 12027 on committee membership.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and all moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time, and there are, in fact, 4 questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Shona Robinson is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Jackie Bailey will fall by way of preemption. So the first question is that Amendment 12010.5 in the name of Shona Robinson, which seeks to amend Motion 12010 in the name of Douglas Ross on UK COVID-19 inquiry revelations, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, and therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system. Thank you.